Good evening, everybody. We are back for another edition of Reasonable Doubt, sponsored by the Harris County Criminal Lawyers Association. I'm your host, Jimmy Yardwine, along with my co-host, Julio Vela. What's up, man?
How you doing, dude?
Well, you know, we've had a lot of unexpected things come up the last 2 weeks.
One thing was expected. Congratulations.
Thank you, but it just came a little earlier than we thought. So, yeah, we got babies being born. We got production people unexpectedly taking some time off. But we're back, and coincidentally, we come back the same night as the Republican debate right down the road here over at U of H. But those of you who are tuned in, we appreciate it. We've got a lot of great topics to get to tonight. We'll take your phone calls starting at 830. 713-807-1794 is the number. We also got Twitter up and going, at HCCLA_TV. Send us your questions. Send us your comments. Our guest tonight, two criminal defense attorneys, Abigail Anastasio.
Good evening.
Thank you for joining us. And Paul Morgan. Paul, thanks for joining us, man.
Good evening.
Appreciate it. Guys, we got a lot of good stuff that's happened in the last 2 weeks, and I apologize to the guests that we've had to bump. We're going to get you back on. We will find a date and get you back on. I do want to apologize for that. Just circumstances and Mother Nature and life sometimes grab a hold of things, but we're going to get you on the show, and we're going to have another great round of topics, I'm sure, to talk about. But one of the first things I want to get to, guys, is this Harris County safety zones that's going on. We talked about it last year, Julio. I can't remember exactly when, but when the first round of these injunctions came up. And for those of y'all who don't know, what's going on is the Harris County Attorney's Office, in conjunction with the District Attorney's Office, they're filing civil injunctions to try and keep gang members out of certain areas in Harris County. And the latest one involves the South Lawn area. And I guess there was the Haverstock one last year, and then another one I'm blanking on the area. But you can see the map up here on our screen. We've got the South Lawn Safety Zone, which is an area south of Old Spanish Trail, you know, between Cullen Boulevard and 288 on its east and west boundaries, and then all the way down to about 610 on its south boundaries. So it's about a 2-mile by 2-mile radius, guys. And what they've done, I know all of y'all here are familiar with this, but again, they've gone into civil court, and the case right now, I believe, is pending in front of Judge Smoots Hogan. But they are trying to enjoin these gang members. A lot of them who they believe to be gang members have pretty good evidence, I believe, that they're known associations with gangs. And they're trying to keep them out of these areas. A lot of controversy about it. So it seems like they've been successful twice. I can't imagine they're not going to be successful this time, right, guys?
Well, let me ask our panel this: is it true? Is it really successful? And how are they identifying people as gang members? We'll start there. Do y'all know how or why?
I believe that the HPD has some sort of policy whereby anytime someone is suspected or anytime an incident occurs and there may be gang activity related, they code it as gang activity. So it's very arbitrary. And after a certain number of events involving a person coded as gang activity, then they identify that person as a gang member. But again, it's very arbitrary. And so that's one of the problems.
But is it really arbitrary? I mean, that's my question that I have in this, because I know a lot of people are coming out and saying it's violating constitutional rights. It's taking away, you know, the liberties of these gentlemen who are mostly African Americans. But I want to know, is it really arbitrary? What's the evidence on this, that it's arbitrary? Because I keep hearing that come up, but I want to know what makes it arbitrary.
Is it the, and let me back that up and say, is it the injunction that's arbitrary, or is it the process that's going through this arbitrary? In other words, from what I understand, there's people who are getting served or should and are not being able to appear to challenge the injunction, to challenge their restriction from going to these places. And so I posed this question as well, is it arbitrary, the fact that, you know, primarily it's blacks and Hispanics that are being targeted, but also B, should these individuals who are being excluded from these regions, should they have their day in court to say, this is my home and this is where I live and I deserve my day in court? What do y'all think?
Well, absolutely. Everyone deserves their day in court. So I would agree with you on that, Julio, or not agree, but put that point forward. You know, I understand the objective of this. There are elderly people in these communities who feel like their neighborhoods have been taken over by gang activity. And so I understand it from that perspective. But at the same time, you know, they deserve their due process.
Let me ask you this. How do you think the police are going to use this to get into other things? So is this like automatic PC? Like they see some dude riding in a car who they think shouldn't be there?
Because they may be so-and-so who looks like so-and-so who is one of the 100 people that are no longer allowed to go home.
And they stop that person, they get in the car, and what about the passenger in the back who should be able to be there? Or maybe the guy they stop isn't not supposed to be there. Do you see any problems with the police using this as a ruse to get into further search and seizures or further seizure of contraband or just kind of, I mean, how do y'all see that, or is it not, do you not think that would be an issue? What do you think, Paul?
I think that they would definitely start using gang membership as a gateway to get into more things. Like if they saw someone who may be in a gang enter a premises and they thought, hey, maybe that person shouldn't be there because they're in a gang, they'll go and search their person, go and search their car. Because my understanding of these injunctions is that once these injunctions are put in place, it's actually a criminal offense to go to that area and just be present. You can't, I believe you can't walk on the premises if you've been enjoined from being on the premise. You can't be in a motor vehicle. You can't be on a bicycle. So yes, I think that would definitely open the gateway to more illegal searches and seizures. And I think you're absolutely right with that, Julio.
But do people really care, guys, about whether or not a gang member is going to be subjected to this?
Well, and I think, do we know how these individuals have been identified as gang members?
Well, and that's the other thing. I mean, that's why I get back to this whole arbitrary thing. I mean, I struggle with this, honestly, because, you know, what are the rights of the people who live in this area? You know, what about them? I mean, they have, you know, you mentioned earlier about the ability for these guys to come to court, okay, and defend themselves. And I agree, look, everybody should have their due process rights, of course. I think we can all agree on that. But what about the people who live in that area? They have no ability. These are predominantly, as you can see from the map, these areas of Houston that are low income. These people have no means to fight that. They have no legal recourse to institute their own civil proceedings to try and get these people out. This is the only help they're getting other than calling the cops, which, frankly, everything that law enforcement has done with these anti-gang task force has failed to protect these people. So what about their rights?
Well, I think the article goes on to interview some of the individuals down there who say, I've never had experienced gang problems. You know, I've never had an issue with them. So it goes back to what kind of due process do these people who are going to be enjoined from being there, what kind of process do they deserve? Do you think it's, let me just add as a broader question, what do you think, Abigail? Do you think it's right, and on what level, to stop individuals from going to certain parts of the town?
Well, I've thought about this a lot, and I kind of liken it to, you know, a magistrate's emergency protective order or, you know, a sex offender. It's sort of the same concept. And, you know, obviously, as a defense attorney, I have some issues with some of the protective orders that are are issued in my cases, especially when the case is dismissed on the first setting and the protective order is still in place. You know, at the end of the day, I understand both sides. People do have rights to feel safe and comfortable in their neighborhood, but at the same time, we need to make sure that this process, in order to keep someone from going to their own home, it has to be pretty solid. And right now, I kind of feel like we don't know exactly how these people are being determined to be gang members. And until that is a little bit more revealed to the public, you know, what exactly have these people done? Why exactly are they coded as a gang member? Until that's clear and until they can appear in court and have that presented, no, I don't think it's okay to exclude someone from a certain area.
Paul, do you think there are issues with the government or the police being able to identify or label an individual as a gang member and then using that to go forward and what problems do you see with that? Or what's your opinion on that?
Well, essentially, if the police can go and willy-nilly call anyone a gang member, okay, they're gonna be able to basically point the finger and cause someone to have to go through an entire court proceeding just to go home, okay? I think there needs to be a rigid system. Like, there needs to be the Texas Department of Public Safety has a gang membership database that they use, that they check. Do we have something like that in place? If there's something like that in place, then you would have objective criteria to check these injunctions against. But I don't think something like that is in place. And if you're going to go ahead and take someone away from where they're living, I think you definitely need something a lot more objective.
Do you think it's fair?
I personally don't think it's fair. Just because you're associated with a gang doesn't mean you shouldn't be able to go home. You should, if you're going to be deprived of your way to where you live or of your liberty, you should be doing something wrong. You should be committing a crime. You shouldn't just be part of a gang. In that article, that article talks about how some of the people who were enjoined or had injunctions filed against them were just part of a gang just because it was the thing to do. It wasn't because they were violent. It wasn't because they were causing a commotion or doing something wrong. It was just something that they did while growing up. They were just part of a gang. Doesn't speak to their character.
And doesn't this create an issue? I mean, I struggle with this because I think that given the limited size of where they're trying to shut these things down, I ultimately think that a court might say this is narrowly tailored enough where you're not per se banishing someone from the community. There's the argument about banishment being such cruel and unusual punishment. Back in the day where, you know, Britain used to send people to Australia to get rid of them or over here to America to get rid of them. We're not going to that extreme. We're not saying you can't go in the city of Houston. We're not kicking you out to Beaumont or wherever. And I think ultimately that may be where an appellate court who reviews this say it's narrowly tailored enough. But doesn't it just shift the problem from one small area to another?
It's almost like that scenario where, you know, you squeeze one part of the balloon, another part pops out. I think we got a phone coming through.
We do. We have our first call. It's early, but we'll take it anyway. Hello, welcome to Reasonable Doubt.
Yeah, you guys keep talking about how this is where people just come and go and all this. But you talk about people who live there, they're right.
Yeah.
Isn't this where these folks live? It's their home. It's where they've grown up. It's the only place they know. And we're talking about, in some cases, teenagers. So if they can't go home, some of the stories I've read is they're going to have to be out on the street. They're going to be homeless now. And all the family that they need, little square box, the only places they can go is back in that little square box. So correct me if I'm wrong, but our government is all about the individual. And we're respecting the individual's rights over the community's rights and over the group's rights. And so if all of a sudden we're saying, you know what, these individuals' rights are not as important as the group's rights, is that a divide from where our government has come from and where it's been established?
Yeah, I hear your point. I mean, that's the struggle with this case because you've got two competing individual rights. I mean, you've got obviously these alleged gang members, maybe proven, who knows, their individual rights. But you've also got the other people who live there, the elderly people, the other people who aren't committing crimes. You've got their rights. And so this is, I mean, I hear what the caller's saying about the individual trumps community, but I think it's even more of you've got two sets of individual rights, and how do we best address that? And I understand what the county attorney and the DA's office is doing. It you know, it's a little bit, you know, as I said in my blog post for this week, it's where the government's role of protecting the public clashes with individual rights. I mean, I think that some would argue, a lot of people would argue, that the purpose of government is to protect us, which I think is what the intent is here. But again, you do have individual rights. And I mean, it's a real struggle. It's a real struggle in this case.
Well, and I think if the government is going to enjoin people from going to certain areas of their town to their home, the very least that the government can do is protect their due process rights. Have a hearing, have them show up with counsel, and if they can't afford counsel, I think they need to be given counsel, because violations of these injunctions has jail as a penalty. And I think that's what the government needs to do at the very least to protect those rights.
Well, and it's really easy for the judge in this case to issue a bitch warrant to bring these people who were served. I mean, obviously, look, the people who the petition was just left on their doorstep or something like that, it may be difficult. I mean, look, that happens all the time in the civil world, where you get a default judgment granted against you. You know, look, if as long as they got proper service on you, you know, your rights weren't violated. But I think with the guys who are in prison, the easy answer there is get a bench warrant.
Absolutely.
Yep.
Get a bench warrant. Bring them over here.
Let me ask you this on the back end. Okay, so the guy is in who's not supposed to be there, is in an apartment complex, gets charged up with a criminal trespass. How is that individual treated differently in the criminal system now on a criminal trespass charge? And what is your experience with that?
Well, with the Haverstock cases, they were making it a minimum 180-day recommendation for these criminal trespass charges. You know,
what would you see on a normal trespass, for example?
It depends on the history of the person. But generally speaking, I mean, you have anywhere from time served to 20 days in Harris County Jail. And then now you're coming in with 180 days to start. I mean, there's no reason not to take that case to trial. So,
but again, you know, I hear what you're saying. I mean, if they're asking for the maximum, what's the point in taking it to trial? But isn't this all about sending the message? Isn't that their goal here? I mean, they're not really trying to deal on this. They're trying to send a message like, look, you violate this, we're just send the max, give you the max.
Well, what is the message that we're really trying to send? The new mayor has come in, and the mayor has recognized that we have serious financial issues here in Houston. Mm-hmm. And the price tag that comes with it, with enforcing this injunction is hefty. And what exactly is it that we're accomplishing by keeping gang members from going home? What is it that they've exactly done that has bettered the community?
I go back to, you're just shifting the problem. They're just going to go to a new area. So, I mean, that's really what I see as the issue here is, we can talk all day about individual rights and everything else, and I think the intent obviously is to protect those who are living there, who aren't committing crimes, and who are, you know, caught in the crossfire, so to speak. But you're just shifting the problem to a new area.
Well, I would also say that, you know, when I read articles, they say they've seen crime reduction in those areas, but I haven't seen any quantification. What exactly was the reduction? By how much? Maybe if it's very substantial or significant, maybe there's something to it. But, you know, where are these people going?
Right.
They're going somewhere else, and the crime is going to follow if, in fact, that was the case to begin with.
Well, and it's not like they're moving out of state, you know, or moving. They're coming back here. They don't have the means to pick up and put everything in a U-Haul and go to Florida. I mean, they're staying here. So you're just shifting it to another area of the city.
And I think that's what the caller was talking about,
yeah,
is that you're taking these teenagers, you're taking them out of their house, and and you label them as a problem, but you're also making them homeless, which means they're going to be even more desperate, which means they're going to create even more problems. And if they weren't a problem to begin with, they're going to become an even bigger problem now.
Well, and I think what I have seen in the Haverstock scenario, which is another area of town where they have enjoined individuals from going, I have seen the DA's office in that scenario where even individuals who are not listed as the people who are enjoined from being there, anybody who picks up a case in that area automatically gets treated differently than another individual with the same type of offense in a different area. So, for example, in the Haverstock cases, we'd get a 180-day offer for an individual that hasn't been enjoined specifically from being in that area, but is still being treated as though that individual should have been enjoined from that area. And what I'm afraid to see is there's going to be individuals in this new area who are similarly situated but treated differently. And I think we have equal protection issues, and I think we have equal protection problems with that. And I'm curious to see if there's any safeguards, if there's any protections, or even if the DA's office even knows that there's other individuals in that area that may be accused of a crime but shouldn't be treated the same way as individuals who are enjoined from being there.
I'm going to love to see the hearing on this. I mean, I really will, because I think it'll be interesting, given that we've already had two others. This latest one, I mean, it's going to be ripe for appellate challenges, I think, down the road.
Well, earlier, and I'm going to take your offer, Paul. Earlier, Paul said if I ever have to drive to that area, Paul would be with me and drive with me. Because I'm getting arrested. But I'm going to have Paul, Abigail, and Jimmy there, and everybody could be straight, and they say, no, he's with me. Okay? So I'll take you up on it. Forget it. So,
you're welcome.
Thank you.
Let's move to another struggle between the government and individual rights, and that is this battle over the iPhone out in California with what Apple is doing. And guys, this is really, really big, in my opinion. This is bigger than what we just talked about, the safety zone.
Absolutely.
And everything else, because this goes to a much broader privacy right. It goes to a much broader security issue. I mean, I'm a big user of Apple products, as everyone can see. And so I applaud them for standing up. I mean, it's what we all want to have happen. And, I think today, if you've watched it, the director of the FBI, James Comey, has kind of backtracked a little bit off of his stance. And he understands. He even testified to Congress and said, I understand this is probably one of the hardest questions I've ever had to deal with as FBI director. Now, I don't think that's really the truth, considering this guy was involved in all the torture memos and everything else. I'm not sure that the iPhone of whether or not to create a back door is the toughest legal decision he's ever had to make in his life. But
well, set it up for us. I mean, what's the scenario?
Yeah, so I mean, they've got this iPhone 5S, an older iPhone, but they want Apple. The FBI wants Apple to basically write a software that lets them in the back door. Because as anybody who has an Apple product knows, if you've got a passcode on it, if you enter it in wrong 10 times, it shuts down. It locks you out of the phone. And good luck getting in. You're not doing it. And so the current FBI software, runs what it can, but they get locked out a bunch. And they've got a ton of iPhones that's sitting around because they're worried that they can't, they'll get locked out permanently and never be able to access the information on this phone. Now, the interesting thing is they want to access one of the shooter's phones in San Bernardino. So it's not like we have an active criminal case going. We have an investigation, and the information they want out of this phone is to see who this dead guy is connected to. So there's no active criminal case. It's not like they've got a search warrant for an active criminal case. They've got a search warrant that they put before a federal magistrate to try and go get information in a much larger and broader terror investigation. And so as part of that, they've submitted a request and got a court order out in California that ordered Apple to basically create this software to unlock the phone, which is just absurd. It's absurd, and I don't think that a private company should be forced to do the government's work for them.
What says you, Abigail?
I think it's absurd as well. If the government can't hack into a phone, I mean, really? You're going to ask a private company to assist you to an investigation? Absolutely. Apple has no obligation or duty to help in any way, shape, or form, and they shouldn't. Absolutely not.
Well, and this would be the equivalent of, you know, Master Lock making one key to give to law enforcement to go break into the locks, you know, that they have. Or it would be the equivalent of, let's say, you know, your home security company writing a master code that anybody could just go into your home and undo your alarm.
But how is that any different from a judge ordering and signing a search warrant to get into a particular item?
Well, fine, they can.
Yeah.
But they do it themselves. They don't get the assistance of Apple to do so. If they want to go in the phone, go in it.
But shouldn't this be in the name of terrorism and in the name of national security? Shouldn't this be the case that Apple needs to comply?
I don't think that we should even put a label on it. It could be any case, and it should be treated exactly the same.
Look, if the government is going to force Apple to comply with their demands, okay, Apple does business in China. They do business in Russia. They do business in North Korea, you know? I mean, they do business. Their phones are all over the globe, okay? So if, and they may not do business in North Korea because the sanctions may not allow them to do that, but I'm sure that there are probably phones that have made their way into North Korea. You know, their phones are global, okay? And so you give them this key, this backdoor key, and it ends up in the hands of the Chinese or the Russians. You don't think they're going to be able to access and backdoor into everybody's phone?
Paul, what says you? I'm the United States government. I should be able to do that in the name of national security.
Okay, I think once you give the government this backdoor key, I think they're going to use it the same way that they use Stingray technology. They're going to use it and not tell you about it. I think once this key goes out, I think it's not only going to be just used by the government. It's going to be used by any hacker who can get their hands on it.
Yeah.
This key should not be generated.
I mean, Stingray technology is the least of my concerns. Frankly, I'm not worried about the government using it as much as I am the government not protecting it. I mean, you know, okay, let's say they do get it and ultimately they do prevail. My concern is not that necessarily that they get it, which is a concern, but even higher than that, is that they fail to protect it. They've done such a great job with Snowden and everything else. Look at all the CIA leaks and all the stuff that leaks out of our government. What's to stop some whistleblower or somebody to infiltrate the government, take this key and put it on the black market? And like you said, let every hacker in the world have access to it.
Well, that'll never happen.
Really?
Oh, wait, no, that's right. So to be clear, is Apple just like running game all over the United States government? We are the United States of America, and there's not someone who can break into the iPhone?
Best and the brightest, man.
Okay, so this was Paul's advice earlier. No, maybe not. Maybe he'd take credit.
You guys had a lot of pre-show conversation here.
This is Paul's advice. Look, everybody get an iPhone, put a lock on it. They can't dump your phone. They can't do it. They can't. The phone, I don't know how many times I've lost the case because of this phone. Not this one, because I got a code on it. Because the government comes in and dumps your phone. Get an iPhone, lock it up. That's it. Is that right? Is that literally what's happening here? That Apple that is outgaming the the highest levels of FBI security?
Well,
apparently
I don't know that they're out gaming necessarily, but I mean, I believe that they have created a very, very high level security program to encrypt their phones. And, you know, yeah, the purpose is to prevent people from getting in, including the government. I mean, you know, no matter who you get, the smartest hackers in the world haven't been able to get it. So even if the FBI has the smartest people working in that back room, They're not getting in either.
And to me, that sounds like a selling point. That sounds like what that particular characteristic right there, that sounds like it makes iPhone the superior phone. Like, I would buy iPhone now just because I know that if I ever lost it, or, you know, God forbid a warrant got executed, yeah, even the FBI's not even going to be able to get my phone.
Well, that's the argument from all the law enforcement that's out there. Devin Anderson has come out and said they have several iPhones that have, you know, are waiting to be accessed. Really? The Manhattan DA, Cyrus Vance, he's come out and said this is a problem. They've basically likened it to the Wild West, so to speak, and that Apple's not being a good corporate citizen because they're not assisting the government. Oh, well, please. That's not their job. Their job is not to assist the government. You know, that and what gets me there is because I don't know if you guys have followed on the federal side, but you have this memo that has come out recently from the deputy AG talking about how corporations are supposed to assist the government in order to, in these FCPA investigations, and that corporate assistance will, you know, help us look favorably upon a resolution of your case. I mean, it just sounds like they're setting it up when Apple's done nothing wrong. Why is Apple, who has done nothing criminal in this case, why are they being forced to cooperate and assist the government? I mean, that's something for a cooperator to do in a damn federal case. It is. And they're not a cooperator. They're a corporation. They're a corporation who has customers. And they're protecting us. I think it's a great thing. I really do. I hope Apple wins this. And they've got some really good lawyers. They filed today, I believe it was today, and they've got Gibson, Dunn, and Crutcher, and they filed a 65-page brief that's pretty amazing. And they started off by saying that it's got a really good opening line. It says, this is not a case about one isolated iPhone. Rather, this is a case about the Department of Justice and the FBI seeking through the courts a dangerous power that Congress and the American people have withheld, the ability to force companies like Apple to undermine the basic security and privacy interests of hundreds of millions of individuals around the globe. That sums it up perfectly.
That does. That sums it up perfectly. I don't even know why this is a topic. If America is still America, then Apple should be under no obligation to assist.
You know why? Because in order to make America great again, we need to get into the iPhones. This is what Trump said. That's what he said. Am I mistaken? Trump supports this. And I'm not going left or right on this. That's what he said. Trump says, hey, judge, I think you're right. Let's unlock the iPhone. Let's do this. And if you're watching Trump at your little Republican convention right now,
I'm sure he has.
All right.
He's live streaming.
We're here. We're right here. Just a heads up.
He's live streaming us at the podium. Exactly what he's doing.
That's good.
Yeah, they're using this archaic All Writs Act. I mean, I'm fascinated by this. I really am. I think it's going to be a very, very interesting case. They've got a ton more test cases around the country. And I don't think it's just one that criminal defense lawyers should be involved in. It's an issue that everybody needs to be aware of and everybody needs to follow because it affects all of your privacy rights. Every single one of them.
Well, I mean, you know, as far as like suspension of habeas corpus rights during terroristic threats or times during our history where they fear enemy combatants, I kind of feel like maybe the government will take some sort of retaliation against Apple and make maybe business hard for them in the United States unless they cooperate.
Well, they're already investigating them for the tax stuff, for the offshore money they've got over in Ireland.
Yeah, Ireland,
so,
right?
I mean, it wouldn't be a stretch to think that they might start hammering that issue a little harder.
So, Abigail, is it appropriate or is it not? What says you? Final word on it. What do you think?
Inappropriate. They have no right to require the government has no right to require a corporation to assist in their search warrant. If you want to go in the phone, go. You have the warrant, go in the phone.
If anybody
don't expect someone to help you.
If anybody at this table says that it's appropriate, I might have to slap you.
I'm just playing devil's advocate here.
Yeah, I know you are. I know you are, but still. I want to look at, let's switch subjects a little bit here and go. There's a bunch of let's say, how should we put this? Conduct issues that have come out over the last couple weeks. We've got the state bar beginning an investigation into Ken Paxton. We've got Charles Sebesta losing his appeal on the disbarment. And today, we have the State Judicial Conduct Commission issuing a ruling on the JP Peterson, up in Waco on the biker stuff. Let's start, guys, with that one. And I've got the opinion right here in front of me, or the letter. I won't even say it's an opinion, because one of the defendants, his lawyer, of course, made a complaint with the State Commission on Judicial Conduct about the actions of this JP in setting $1 million bonds across the board for everybody in Waco on the biker case. For those of y'all who are not aware, there was a little incident at Twin Peaks up in Waco that involved some biker gangs. There was a melee, and some people ended up getting shot and killed. And over 170 people got arrested and got $1 million bonds set on them by this one judge, this one JP up in Waco. There was a complaint arguing that what he did was improper, that he made some public comments about everything, that those were also improper. And the commission today, and I want to read it here because I think the language is important, and they start off with the usual platitudes of, we appreciate the allegations raised in your complaint. But they say, in its discretion, the commission determined that the judge's conduct in this particular instance, while not necessarily appropriate, did not rise to the level of sanctionable misconduct. Really? They ordered him to take a class. A class.
Like a criminal law 101 class?
Criminal law 101.
On how to affix the amount of bail upon a citizen in this state. Paul, what says you?
Well, first off, getting $1 million bail is like getting a no bond. No one can make $1 million bail. I don't think $1 million bail has ever been made, unless someone in the table feels like they can correct me.
I'm pretty sure $1 million bail's been made by some people.
By somebody out there?
Yeah, I mean, I can attest that I think some of those guys in Enron made their $1 million bonds.
All right, with those a couple of exceptions, $1 million bail is like a no bond.
Right.
So if you're going to set the bond that high, there has to be, you have to take all the consideration.
Sure.
You have to look at all the factors, the ties to the community, the criminal history, whether they're constitutionally entitled to a bond. The fact that this JP judge just flatly set out several million-dollar bonds shows that he wasn't doing his job. He was just trying to get it over and done with. And he's playing with people's lives. People can't make those bonds, and they're going to sit incarcerated and in custody, waiting their day in trial, maybe on something that they didn't do. Everyone's presumed innocent until they have their day in trial. So why are these bonds so high?
Well, I'm not going to put it any further than this. I, as someone who represents a defendant in that particular Twin Peaks case, I don't know that those bonds weren't purposefully set high to detain people purposefully. I'm not going to get into that right now, but perhaps that's why the ruling came down as it did.
So there's a law or a case law that says, you know, and I think it's even codified, if I'm not mistaken, that it cannot be used as an instrument of oppression. What is
it
that?
It is every day.
What does that mean for a bail to be used as an instrument of oppression, and do we see it?
Well, what you see commonly is that someone gets a high bond and that they have to stay in custody, and they stay in custody for so long that they just want to plead out. And they want to plead out because they don't want to wait another 6 months for a trial setting. So these bonds could be set this high just to kind of get the plea mill going and get this case underway.
Paul Looney sent an interesting comment, and Paul has been on our show. He has one of the I don't even know how you would couch this, but I guess one of the higher profile guys in this case. He's been asking for a speedy trial, didn't get it. And Paul kind of said he wished that the other lawyers would have waited in filing this complaint until we've been able to have some trials. That hopefully by having the trials and by getting everybody's story out there, and obviously hopefully getting some acquittals in this case, and showing just the, you know, ineptitude of the judge in this case in setting this, and how unfair it was, and how nobody really considered the facts in this. He wished they would have waited till after we had had a few trials to have some more evidence to show. I mean, I think his point is pretty spot on, that maybe, because we can't know with any kind of certainty, but maybe this would have played out differently, and they wouldn't have just given him a go attend a counseling class and be on your way. You know?
What kind of class did he get? I mean, is it like, is it like criminal law 101? Like,
the way it was told to me, and let me see if I have it here, attend counseling on criminal law and the ethics of setting bonds. Now, where the hell do you go to find that class? I mean, that's not exactly on your leisure learning, you know?
I mean, he's a judge.
Yeah.
Is this a group class? Like, can I go to it too?
I mean, I would love to find out where one goes to, because I would love to sit in on it and just see what they're talking about.
I want to sit in on that as well.
Abigail, what should a judge use to affix an amount of bail that's appropriate?
Well, you have to consider their financial resources. And in this case, a lot of these people had no financial resources, and as a result of being held at such a high bond, lost their jobs, were unable to attain a job subsequent to this happening. That's just one of my complaints. You're supposed to ensure that the defendant returns to any hearings or court settings that they have. That is the purpose of bail. It is not meant to be punitive, and in this case, it was clearly punitive. And, you know, a class is not sufficient in this instance.
And moreover, what message does this send? At the end of every criminal case, prosecutors always try to argue, we need to send a message to the community and level this heavy sentence against this defendant. What message does this send to other judges that they can set bonds like this and just get away with it? That the only thing that will happen is that they'll just get a class?
Well, that's a good point, actually, Paul. It makes, you know, asking for, you know, a bond hearing kind of pointless, because they can set any bond and there's no recourse for us.
But there never has been. The problem is that even from an appellate standpoint, there's never been a recourse, because the time to appeal you go in and you make a writ to have your client's bond reduced. Okay, you take it up on appeal. Guess what? It's not like it stays the case, because you want your client's case to still go forward. But by the time the appellate court deals with the issue, the case has been over and done with. So there's really no repercussions.
I should know this, but is it the JP courts that you don't have to be a lawyer to be a judge?
I think that's...
That's the JP courts.
That's correct.
But
JP?
This was some sort of magistrate.
He's a JP. I know that. He was a justice of the peace.
He was a
justice of the peace. I do think for a justice of the peace, you have to be a lawyer. I think it's municipal court. You may not have to be necessarily a lawyer.
Well, there are non-lawyers that are JPs in Harris County.
That
I think it's the JP. I don't know.
We got a phone call. Let's hop over to the phone lines. Take our next caller. Hello. Welcome to Reasonable Doubt. Thanks for calling.
Yeah. I was wondering if you find a judge that is doing something wrong, maybe even criminal, are you able to report them and expect something to be done about it?
Well, that's a great question. Thanks for the call. You do expect to make a report. And I think actually, any lawyer that sees any kind of misconduct or not just on a judge, but even another lawyer, you're obligated to make a report to the state bar. If you see another lawyer committing misconduct, you have an obligation at that point, I think, to report it to the state bar.
And to go on what the caller was saying is, we make the report, but backing up, dovetailing what you said, Jimmy, is the client's still suffering in the meantime. We see it all the time, you know, for example, during a case, a trial, the judge will just overrule your objection, for example, and then he'll just say, appeal me. Go ahead, appeal me. While your guy stays in jail or receives his punishment through the process. And that's kind of, that's a big problem. Where is the immediate relief? And ultimately, to go on what the caller was saying, the remedy is, oh, we'll just have this judge take a class.
An ethics class.
Let's just sit down, we'll talk about it, we'll say, hey, you know, you should probably think about doing this. But you're exactly right. And you know the remedy, caller? Vote. Get these people out of office who are clearly demonstrated to not be fit for service. And that is the key. It's my opinion.
Somebody who could face some ethical issues and a potential disbarment to go along with his other legal problems is Ken Paxton. talking about reports being made to disciplinary bodies. So the state bar last week ordered an investigation. I guess 2 weeks ago now. I guess I'm a little off because we've been out for so long. But 2 weeks ago, they ordered an investigation into Ken Paxton and his letter, which directed the county clerks telling them that they could opt out of issuing marriage licenses in the wake of the Supreme Court ruling. Obviously, there was a complaint made saying that, look, he's the attorney general. He's sworn to uphold the laws of this state and the United States. And that letter right there, he ain't doing it. And so there was a grievance made. Do you think, you guys think this has any teeth? And what's the reality? I mean, look, we saw what happened with Governor Perry's case this week on appeal. I mean, what's the reality given what the State Judicial Conduct Commission did, what we know about what the state bar does in a lot of cases? What's the reality of him getting disbarred for this?
What do you think, Paul?
I'm going to have to think about that and pass that to you.
You're punting on the question? You can't do that when you come on a talk show. You can't punt on the question, Paul.
Let me ask you this, Paul. Let me rephrase. Let me ask you this then, Paul. Okay. Think about it. It's the highest level prosecutor in the state. How does it look, and what's your personal opinion about the highest level prosecutor in the state being not only called up for potential, you know, losing his bar license, but also being under indictment for three other separate offenses?
Well, first off, if you're under indictment for, I think he's under indictment for securities fraud plus some other financial crime. If you're under,
don't forget the new investigation. It's also coming on the real estate deal.
Yeah, let's not forget that. If you're under indictment for a serious offense, you shouldn't be in office. You have no business policing other people and trying to deprive other people's freedom if you yourself are committing criminal acts.
But if he was your client, wouldn't you say he's innocent until proven guilty? Oh, gotcha on that one. Pat, got your tongue there.
While that may be true, those in office take an oath. And that oath is in our Texas Code of Criminal Procedure. And they take an oath to seek justice.
But I think that's what the issue is here. I think I don't quarrel so much with him keeping his job while under indictment, because I don't think anybody, frankly, unless the state removes him, which we know that's not going to happen unless Governor Abbott would remove him. It's the equivalent of if you picked up a crime and were under indictment, and let's say you didn't work for yourself, but you worked at a law firm or you worked at some company, they would have the right to terminate you for the indictment, okay? But the issue here, as I see it, is he is not following his oath of office. And that's different from defending an indictment. So I understand why we may not like our attorney general to be under indictment. The fact is our governor has made a choice not to remove him from his job. But this seems a little more problematic to me.
That he's not
following his oath.
So let me pose you this question. Paul. A public servant who is not abiding by his oath, what says you?
If you're not abiding by your oath, why would you even want to be in office? It's the issue that we run in with prosecutors or anyone who's in office who's just being overzealous. It's a power trip. That's all it is. And then it results in abuse of power. It results in all sorts of other issues spilling out. If you're there and that's who you are, you're you're just there for the sake of being in a position and you think that you're above the law, that's when we have issues. Especially if you have people underneath you and you're directing them and asking them to not follow the law and saying, hey, you can actually choose to do this. It may result in criminal prosecution, may result in a fine, but I put my stamp of approval on that. That's an issue.
Ultimately, that might be what helps him out here is the fact that he said, you may, you know, face consequences for this action, but, you know, I'm not going to take issue with it personally. Do I think anything's going to come of this? Not really.
Well, you know, maybe like a class.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Maybe a class like, you know.
An ethics class?
Yeah. Like a little ethics.
Attorney General 101.
Like maybe get CLE credit for it.
Maybe Supreme Court 101.
Yeah, you know.
What Supreme Court rulings hold precedent?
There could be one. You know, a little. That was funny. And I think
if they're a majority or a plurality, what, you know.
I think Paul just called out Ken Paxton on reasonable doubt, which is awesome. That is so awesome.
Guys, what about this Sebesta losing his appeal? Charles Sebesta, of course, was the prosecutor on Anthony Graves' case, who Anthony Graves was our first guest when I took over this show and when Damon and I took it over. Of course, he was later exonerated for a crime he did not commit. And Charles Sebesta, the prosecutor in that case, was disbarred for illegally withholding evidence. And he appealed it. He brought up this website, made this website trying to defend himself and defend his actions. And the state bar said, nope, we're denying your appeal. You stayed disbarred.
Good riddance.
Yeah.
So
absolutely. We don't need him on our state bar.
So okay. Just I'm tossing it out there. How often do we see prosecutorial misconduct or things that, you know, should be turned over that's not, and what are their remedies, if any?
When it comes down to prosecutorial misconduct, there are several different remedies that you can seek. You can mainly file a motion to dismiss if the prosecutorial misconduct is egregious. You can file a motion to quash and explain how the misconduct has deprived your client of a fair trial. But to spot it is difficult because it's so dependent on the particular prosecutor. And moreover, there's so many different moving parts when it comes down to prosecutorial misconduct that it's a broad concept to wrap your brain around. Like, anyone who's part of the prosecutorial team imputes their knowledge upon the prosecutor, and it's the prosecutor's duty to seek out all the evidence in their case, be it Brady evidence, be it incriminating evidence. The prosecutor is supposed to know everything that their agents know. Now, if let's say a police officer has exculpatory evidence and doesn't tell the prosecutor about it, the prosecutor is ultimately going to be the one who gets fried for it. And you ultimately don't get any pretrial remedies with that. That doesn't work. You have to wait until after a conviction and then try to argue that there was some sort of Brady violation. And that's how I feel prosecutorial misconduct can mainly has its teeth is on appeal. I don't think during pretrial you can claim prosecutorial misconduct and effectively do anything good for your client.
Yeah, I would agree with that screaming prosecutorial misconduct from the high heavens usually doesn't inure to your benefit unless A, you have proof and B, you can make a decent record of it pre-trial. I mean, it's and look, I know that a lot of people think that prosecutorial misconduct happens like rain showers happen, you know, here in Houston in the springtime. I just don't think it happens that often. I mean, I think that there are, I don't think it gets called out enough, but I don't think it's some huge rampant problem amongst the entire prosecutorial bar. I think there are a finite few who choose to push the envelope and have tried and have done their damnedest to get away with it and continue to push the envelope. And some of their trainees fall under that. But I don't think it's a plague that afflicts, you know, you've got thousands of prosecutors nationwide, and for people to paint them with a broad brush and say they're all bad apples, you know, it's just like when they say defense lawyers do scuzzy things and bad things. There are a few that do. There are a few that will, you know, submit false affidavits that will. I saw one today that there was some guy who had the audacity to sign orders from a judge. You know, I mean, you know, so defense lawyers do bad stuff. So I think that painting the broad brush of prosecutorial misconduct on everybody is unfair. But I do agree with you, Paul, that I think that, you know, your remedy is going to be on appeal because you're not doing your client any favors by screaming this stuff before you have proof.
Yes, and you're also showing your hand. Unless you got a real, real, real good claim of prosecutorial misconduct, I think you have to wait until after trial. But I don't think a lot of prosecutorial misconduct is also intentional. Like for example,
absolutely.
I represented a guy once who had four habitual counts against him. He went through a couple prosecutors. It was a number two case, and the case got really old, and they were at 25 years for 8 months solid. The thing got set for trial, and finally one of the prosecutors had to look into the case, and they found out that the lead investigator in the case was under a criminal investigation. And it wasn't until like a couple days before trial that I got this untimely Brady disclosure, and all of a sudden the 25 years came down to 5. You know, it's just little stuff like that. The prosecutors are mainly overworked. They have more cases than they know what to do with. They have too many people that they need to talk to. And sometimes how they mishandle the case is unintentional, even though it's still them mishandling the case.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I think that prosecutors, for the most part, are overworked. I mean, that a lot of these are not intentional. They're just, they're overworked. And like all of us, they're underpaid, you know. But I echo your sentiments. I think that a lot of the stuff that the reason we get good deals at the end is because stuff does come up, and it's by no fault of the prosecutor. I mean, I've seen cases where, you know, an officer failed to turn over witness interviews, and that witness interview ended up being the linchpin in the case. So I'm getting flashed at. We only got a couple. 30 seconds left here, man.
What do you?
We gotta start wrapping it up.
It's been quick. I know. It's a fast show. It's a good show. It's a good show.
Not paying attention to the time here.
Hey, look. But once again, I am taking your deal up on riding through the safety zone.
Well, just tell me when and where.
Yeah, we gotta wrap it up, guys. Abigail, Anastasio, Paul Morgan. Appreciate you guys being on. It was a great time having you on this week. Julio, as always, man, good times. We're going to be back next week. Who are our guests next week?
Next week, I got it.
Got him?
Yes. Before we go, let me tell you who's coming on next week. I got to unlock my iPhone, you know?
Get a court order.
next week on the show. Oh, great. We got Mike Driver, the one and only. And Joseph Ruiz.
There you go.
It's going to be great.
We're going to be back next week, ladies and gentlemen. Mike Driver, Joseph Ruiz. Be sure to tune in. Have a great night.